I'm Andrew Hiley, FDCEO. This is my tech director and my content. So we'd love to give you a tour around our facilities, talk to you about the processes, and what it takes to build a pinball machine, and then answer the questions you might have. So here we are in the factory. We started off when you came into the industrial estate to begin with, and we're on the right hand side. Very end, there's like an ambulance space. And to the right of that, there's was Unit 9. That was where we started life off as pinball. So it's not strictly true. We started off outside the pinball at the back of my garage. So we started off there with services out of my house building that. And then we realised we're running out of space, of course, as you would do. And then we moved my garage to 40,000 square foot factory, which is Unit 9 down there. And then we moved here, which is 42,000 square feet. So we almost tripled in size. We actually already manufactured something last year. We were approached by Bacardi, or representatives of Bacardi, to make a promotional item for something that was going to be part of a multi-billion-dollar campaign all across the globe. So, the extra story behind that, we were actually approached in summer 2013 to do something for them. They met with a different company, but then came back around Christmas time and said, we went with such a company, weren't happy with what they did, can you do it for us? And it's bad news. Half to do. So nobody else was prepared to take them. And even Bacardi's own procurement department quoted of like 9 months to turn this about. So we did it, took it off, and what you see is over there by the door, which took 4.5 months to design, build, and ship out 251 games for the biggest private energy drinks company in the world. So not bad for the first customer. And we've got amazing feedback. I mean, we've got a great quote. You see it on the banner next to the game over there. Global marketing director of Cardi, which is the only global CEO. Loved it as well, saw it and loved it. I'll tell you this one very interesting story, which you might find amusing, is that we had like a 6-month warranty for our games going out there, and they've been shipped out all over the world. And so, who knows what we would need for any problems and so on, but we thought we bought a quality machine. We had one service call for 6 months, and if you look at our game down there, there's a lithium-ion battery. The spec was, this game would go to 4 different pubs every night. We have LEDs in there, so we have this big, bulky lithium-ion battery that would basically spec for 8 hours. And so, this thing, 4 hours in the night, after even a year and a half, you'd still be able to get 4 hours usage because it's designed for 8 hours. So, we had this one service call, a really panicked woman at Bacardi, saying, oh yeah, we need a couple of hundred batteries for the US market, how soon can you get them? We're like, what's going on here? Happening. So anyway, they wanted prices for this game, prices, there's nothing to another week. And then we got a phone call saying, we understand what happened. They didn't realise they had to recharge the batteries. So I always say, if we had the never-ending, unrechargeable battery, I think we'd be making something a little bit more interesting. And we reached then driving around in the world. Anyway, so that was quite an amusing story, but it went very well for us, and we learned a lot about manufacturing, just from that one item there. About the importance of quality control, keeping on top of the suppliers, making sure you have all the items you need when you start production. So here we are now, we realised very early on in the production process, we're going to run out of space very quickly. We've got a low-tech item over there, and a pinball machine is like 10-20 times more complicated. Electronics, all kinds of things. And just the sheer size of it meant that if we want to be able to make 200-400 games a month, which was always our goal, to be able to make as many games as we needed to, we're going to quickly outgrow that facility. And that's why what you see is here now. We are a working factory, but we started off small. So our first production run was 20 games. We shipped out 22 games. We shipped out 13 of those globally. And we have another, we have the remaining 9 going out in about a week and a half's time. Then we're starting on exporting more games. But by the end of the year, our target is to be up to 200 games a month plus, especially when we get to production of our second title, April. So we'll start production around November, 200 odd games up from there. So we need the facilities to go into. And that's the reason why we have a nice big empty unit for the UK Pinball Party this year. So maybe it's not going to be the same next year because we run out of space, as in November. So that's kind of where we are at the moment. And we want to talk you through the whole process really and show you the stuff that we've bought over the last sort of 12 months. And really, every start upstairs, we have like we have a software designer there, design engineer. So he does all of our design work, and he basically transforms it completely to what our designers are looking to. And we're working with some of the industry's best. Dave Sanders is best up and coming, I believe, designer with the pinball machines. I'm sure anybody's taken a lot of the show, the shots, the geometry and everything. You know, everybody comments just how nice they are, how well the game goes to play. And we also work with John Trudeau. We have a game in the bank for him, so ready to build that at some stage in the near future. And then, of course, Barry Alston, who works all last year, he's designed games with four players, which are ready, prototypes ready to be built. We have kind of like a backlog of games. So it's going to be quite exciting for 12 to 16 months when we aim to have all four of our games out in the market by the end of next year. So that is our goal. And what some people might think is, well, you're taking so long to get the first game out of the door. How can you say you're getting the other games? The thing is, the first game is always by far the hardest one to go and build. Yeah, because we designed everything from the ground up. Everything from the mechanisms, the software, the hardware, the operating systems. Everything's had to start from scratch. And so once you've got that first game out of there, then 50-70% of the work is already done for your next game. You're just, doing software programming and new playbooks and everything else as well. So we believe that we're set up here now, ready to go to high volume production. And that is where our big next step is going to be, going from 22 to 44 games a month up to 200 games. So everything starts up there from a design perspective, and then we come down here, and this is our prototype.
So I'd like to just sort of
poke your head around the door. This is where we build up our prototypes. We have cards there, trying different things out and so on. We build up our prototypes in there. And then the production sort of happens after that. I'm just going to show a couple of our features over there. And I'll show you some aspects of our cabinets as we're going around and our playfields. But I'm just going to show you a few of our individual components, subset. These are our flip mechanisms, and these are modular by nature. So modularity is a big thing about what we're doing here. In that, I've been a service engineer before, and that's not strictly true. I've bought, sold, repaired, operated, done everything with pinball machines, and I've fixed machines on site, so I know the kind of things that go wrong with them. And you don't want to be there with the spanners and your Allen keys trying to, in a pub, it is dark, loud music blaring. You don't want to be doing that. You want to be able to just drop it out, pair it back in place, or replace it. So our flip mechanisms could be replaced by someone who only needs to know how to use a screwdriver. You undo the screw, pull screws, unplug the connector, and just replace it. It's as easy as that. And that's the same philosophy for all of our major mechanisms and all of our mechanisms as well. And the other thing is about, I don't know how many of you know what about our different games and how we build them. It's because with the modularity, because we're not having like wiring loops, we're like 800 meters worth of wiring, which is a normal pinball. We actually have less than 50 meters of wiring in our machine, so we have like a 16 wiring, which means that it's so much easier for us to build our games. I mean, standard in the industry is 16 to 18 hours build time for a game. Our target, when we're fully up to production, is 6 to 8 hours per machine, which is almost a third of the time to build up our games. And it's less labour, which means we can cost down as well. So, if you'd like to maybe just move over this way, what I'd like to invite you to do is to just pop your heads around the prototype room there, just so you can get an idea.
Yeah.
So you saw the prototype room over there. You'll see dotted around various cabinets in various stages, like the one by the door over there. That was an early prototype cabinet. This one over here, this is a prototype game, which was, pre-production game. So it's not the finished version, but what you do can see there is the artwork and trim. It's the trim for our limited edition. We do either like a gloss red cabinet with a black powder coated metal finish, or black gloss cabinet with red powder coated finish. So that's one variant that you can see over there, but it's still missing items from the LED, like fiber optic wiring, the shape of motor and so on. But that just gives you an idea of what our LEDs look like from the outside. Now what I'd like to show you is we're going to sort of work our way down this way, and these are two of our, behind you here, are two of our newest pieces of equipment. And can anybody tell me what those machines are? Injection molding machines, absolutely. And why have we got those? Well, the thing is, we have very serious aspirations about being not only competing with our main competitors, but being the number one. This is our raison d'etre, this is why we're here. We want to bring people back to being mainstream. And in order to be able to do that, we have to be able to keep our costs down. We need to be able to offer our products to the market at a price which not only competes with our competitors, but hopefully can be even better. So how do we do that? Rather than outsourcing everything, we can start insourcing stuff and start making our own items here. So what these injection molding machines will do will allow us to make things like flipper bags, flipper bushings, the plastic lens inserts that you get in the playfield surface, which we'll show you in a bit. All of these little plastic bits, we can be spending on an insert 35 cents, whereas we go and get a tool made, it costs about $2,000 to get this made. But after that, it's one or two pence, maybe half a pence by the time you've got these on. So you're just churning these things out, and this is the kind of thing you need to do for mass production. But the other element of this is not only from a cost saving point of view, but also from a quality control point of view too. Because one thing that we've learned is the more parts you're getting, the more suppliers, the more you have poor quality, or you have inaccuracies in particular parts. So the more parts you can keep direct control of, the better your whole quality control aspect is going to go and be. And then the third thing is that it's actually just demand as well. So you'd be surprised, we might talk to a supplier and business, but then all of a sudden they've got a big order book from other customers. You go to them and say, that's it, great, you want 100,000 cars. Oh, sorry, you can't do it for another 6 weeks. But we can't just shut our production down like for 6 weeks. We have to keep going. So the more stuff that we can do in-house, the more processes we can take care of, the better we're going to be. So we want to move down to the next piece of equipment down here. So can anybody tell me what this piece of equipment is? CNC machine, absolutely. So why do we have a CNC machine? This is an 8x4. Flathead CNC machine. What this allows us to do is to cut our own width. It can cut wood, plastic, and also thin aluminium as well. But we're not interested about the aluminium, what we're interested in is the wood and the plastic. So we will be cutting all of our own play fields here. It's a fully commissioned machine now. We've got to work out the software on it because it's we've got to merge like SolidWorks software with another piece of equipment we've got to like so they can beat each other. But in the next 4 to 6 weeks we're going to be making our own play fields here, cutting them from here. And we're also going to cut our own plastics as well. So the plastic side panels that you see in our games, the back box panels as well, plus also the plastics on the playfield too. So we'll be cutting all of that out ourselves.
And now you can see that there are already been a big cut out of that first board there.
At the moment we're cutting basic shapes, squares and circles, before we start getting to, you see we're cutting leading on a pavement surface, it's a lot more intricate than that, but start off somewhere, so. So this is part of the process here, so if we carry on going over this way, please.
Wait there, it's still down.
Okay, so we've reached one end of the factory now, and a few things I want to point out to you. You see there's a lot of equipment over here, at the back there, shelving, racking, and other different pieces. Yeah, in order to be able to make 200-300 games a month by the end of the year, we need to have equipment to do it. So we bought in advance a lot of equipment and have it stored down there. I mean, there's a spray booth and an extraction system over there waiting to be connected up. This will allow us to lacquer our own playfields as well in the house. I'm going to go into a bit of detail when we get down to the playfields there as to the whole process, how we start and how we finish. And it's a process that took 2.5 years to get to the bottom of. And I'll tell you some stories about how we got there, you know, printing processes and so on, because it's very intricate, very specialised bit of equipment. Now, being the first UK manufacturer, we can't go knocking on the door of somebody of a playfield manufacturer over here. They're just, you know, people aren't making pinball parts over here, so we have to source the stuff or make the stuff ourselves. So we have a lot of equipment there. What we have back there is we have a locked up store, stock, store for all of our parts. So at any one time we can have well over $100,000 worth of parts in there. And we have our goods in. We have to use the one set of doors now for goods in and goods out. So all the goods come in on pallets, they get stacked on the shelves here, then they get unboxed, and everything gets broken down into individual parts bins. We have, you know, everything is computerised there, so we know exactly how many parts are there for each, for everything. But also part of the process is when you design something in SolidWorks, it can actually tell you a full list of all what we call bill of materials. So you can see, okay, to build this game, we need this number of this number of that, this number of that. So it really helps for stock control and ordering. Now that's our parts store over there, and goods in and out here. Now that will be separated. When we really start to expand towards the end of the year, and we move into the other building there, then we'll have a separate goods out. If you'd like to follow us, be down here, please. So can anybody tell me what this is?
It's a speedy
packer. Yes. Well, anybody any idea what it does?
A
foam, yeah, absolutely. So yeah, we're making games here, but we're shipping them out all over the world. So by the time one gets to Australia, you want it to be in the condition that it left here from. So one of the ways is that you use this sort of material. So everything gets boxed up, but you put this at the corner of each machine on its back, and then on top as well, package the whole thing together. What this system does is computer controlled, is that, and you'll see behind the back here, there are two drums of chemicals. So what you do is you select what size that you want. When the back comes down, two chemicals are squirted in specific quantities, then it starts up a chemical reaction. That chemical reaction, the fluids will expand in size 30 to 40 times within a minute. So you have this bag with this warm liquid in it. Open up the mould here, and for our packing on full throttle, we use two different types of moulds. You'll notice there's other moulds down here. That was actually for the Bacardi, for the packaging system for our Bacardi game. So you put the bag with the liquid in there, shut it, and then you go on and you do the next one. Then a minute later, when you've finished up, you open it up again, you reverse the vacuum, and out pops your materials. As simple as that, yeah. I'm sorry? We didn't do mine, actually. No, that was done by actually. Yeah, sold to the machine. So that's our packaging system there. This is just, this just shows you we have a natural enough arcade here. So, this is just stuff getting repaired and stored and whatever. Stuff that we do in our spare time. Yes, exactly. That takes hopefully when it's working, actually. So, if we work our way, go down there to where the cabinets are in the playfield, I'll discuss more about the playfield. Okay, so I'm just going to tell you a little bit now of some more specifics about how we go and sort of build our machines and the processes. What you see here then is we start off obviously with a blank piece of We start off here with a blank piece of wood, and then that gets CNC'd. And as you see, there's lots of recessed holes throughout here. For example, we have a hole there for the magnets, a hole there where the screen sits into. But you have these recessed holes that all of these, all the nice inserts get glued into. Another interesting thing, which my colleague Shonny there has just given me, is how many people here would consider themselves to be techies, as in do work on pinball machines themselves? Maybe raise a hand, anybody does? So we know that a lot of mechanisms are held in place by T-nuts. But the disadvantage about T-nuts is that you can't put them through places where you have artwork if you're trying to hold things in position. So we use these little sort of grommets, these insert nuts. So what we do is we drill in to 2 millimetres beneath the surface, put these in, and allows us then to screw our mechanisms in. And this is really the key to our modularity, being able to just unscrew stuff and then just remove it very easily. And these all have to be screwed in individually into the plate film. So the first part of the process is then, is that it's after it's cut, inserts are glued in, and then we come to here now to stage two, where you see the plastic lenses are then glued into the plate film. Now these have been glued in, but if you feel something like Gary, just put your hand over there, you see how uneven the surface is there. So what needs to happen next is this must all be sanded down so it's completely flat. And one of the byproducts of sanding these down is these then become very cloudy and you think, oh God, it's not going to work. But the thing is, when you've applied lacquer then it brings back the shine again, so you still have that clarity again, it sort of reverses back round again. So the process then after this is sanded down completely smooth and flat. This then goes off the lacquering. This would have a three coat lacquering process. So 3 coats go onto this, the whole thing gets sanded down, and then after that you have a sealed surface. Now, can anybody tell me how playfields used to be printed in the past?
Four colour process.
Yeah, so screen printing.
Still done that way.
Yeah. I thought that they were digitally printed until recently. But absolutely, silk screening was the way, and that's real old school printing. And we digitally print onto the wood. So if this was an unsealed surface, the ink would just like seep into the wood and it must look dreadful. So you have to seal it, that's why you need the lacquering beforehand. So this then goes off to the printer, and then after it's been printed, it comes back and gets another 3 coats of a 2-part automotive clear coat. And then that gets applied, then it all gets polished, make sure there's no little imperfections in the polish, and then you have your plate ready to be built. But yeah, it took a long time for us to learn and understand the process to get it right. Are we going to what, sorry? Watch this space, about 5 minutes we should show you. So that's the plate process here. We all show you here that we also print plastics as well. So these get printed too, reverse printed. The CMYK print with a white backing there. You need the white backing there so you can properly show the light shining through without those hot spots that you could get otherwise. So I'd like to show you a bit about our cabinets over here. Well, in fact, let's go down here now. This is a half built play field. So this is a play field and you can see the surface that's already been lacquered and finished sort of halfway through the build process at home. But you can see, we talk about the modularity there. As you can see, plastic is sticking through, so it just drops straight through. Same with the pop bumpers here, same with the slingshots there, they just drop straight through as well. And we'll talk about electronics in a minute. So if you'd like to just come through, just behind us here, please. Aspects of our cabinet here, how we build it, why we do, have done things the way that we do. You'll notice here, all the way round, we have a ply carcass. The reason why we've used ply is most pinball machines have always used ply because you can screw things in and out of ply very easily and it holds onto it, it doesn't fall apart. If you use MDF, for example, MDF once or twice and the whole thing starts to disintegrate. And also MDF with the wood, generally, it's a lot heavier, it absorbs moisture, it's much easier for it to break apart. So we keep the carcass as ply, but the outer panels are MDF panels, but they have a special process on them, which is called vacuum foil pan. So what happens is you cut out the MDF panel, you get this like foil, put it in on top, put it into this sort of vacuum oven, the whole thing then comes out, pressed and heated, and comes to these panels here. The great thing about this is it allows us to do many different types of finishes. So this is a gloss black, and we use it's a matte black, and this matte black is what we use on all of our standard edition cabinets. But on our limited edition ones, like the one that you saw over there, it's a gloss red. So our limited edition for four bottles available in gloss black with red powder coated trim and gloss red with black powder coated trim. So we've both options. For different games, we can use different colour options. But the other thing as well that it allows us to do is, let's say you have a lot of oak in your room where you want to put a pinball machine, then you can have oak effect panels on this here, so it really sort of blends in and become a piece of furniture too. But the other positive about having this is we've all seen, you know, graffiti and everything on the sides of pinball machines. Someone's written, "I love my mum," you know, on the side of a cabinet. If you want to change that, normally you can't. You have to sand it down, decal it and everything. With this, all you do is just undo some screws in here and the whole cabinet, the whole side comes off. And around the legs as well, you don't even have to take the legs off because we have the recesses in there too. You just take the old panel off, put a new one in, you're good to go again. And just to demonstrate a few other items about our system here, one of them is the modularity of our games. You can change, I'm sure many of you know, you can change games in one of our cabinets by a game upgrade kit in only 5 minutes. I used to say 15 minutes, I thought we're understanding ourselves here. Because it really is very easy. If you buy a game upgrade, what you get is two side decal panels, back glass artwork panel, you get the play field itself and the software on the stick. So how easy is it to change one of these panels here? What you do is you just put your finger in and you just lift it out. I've actually Gary, you see Gary, all the guys swinging over there. See how easy it is to go through. So you just, you know, drop your new one in, and you're good to go. Same with the back glass panel, you just lift it, pull it out, and that's right. The playfield here, does anybody know how many connectors we have for our playfield? Sorry? Higher than one. We have three. We have this connector here, that's it. Everything is being controlled by here. Other than we have an HDMI cable as well for the screen, and we have a USB cable as well for our connectivity. But that's it, just three connectors. So you literally just lift the playfield up, pull it out, undo your three connectors, and just pull the whole playfield out. Put a new one in, artwork panels, back glass, stick your software stick in, and you've got a brand new game working in your system too. Absolutely, yeah, just space conscious. That's why we designed it this way. The other thing is our boot timer. Does anybody follow us on our YouTube channel? So, does anybody else know what the boot time is for one of our games? 16 seconds. Yeah, you're close. Yeah, 16 seconds is all it takes to boot. So, even if you put your new game software in, it's a 60-second boot for your new game as well. And our games are upgradable as well, either by USB stick for software updates, or even by Wi-Fi as well. We are Wi-Fi enabled. And just to tell you briefly about the Wi-Fi enabling ability, is that you can create a profile online in the future, and then, for example, Gary Flower, and put your photo up there, you can go and, you know, pay for some credits, PayPal or WorldPay, then put your phone up, and also to Facebook and Twitter, you know, Gary's been playing, you know, got the dog and gun in. Not the dog and gun. So this has that social media connectivity too. Also allows operators to be able to keep track of their games. Are they earning? Are they switched on or off? Is there a problem? What part do I need? So yeah, this sort of connectivity is what we're developing at the moment. And so the other thing I wanted to show you very briefly is you see these rails here. We have on the back of our playfields, we have this like little playfield banana or metal piece. And it slides along here, but when it gets to these nylon blocks there, it rotates in there, which means that you can have your play field at that angle or at that angle. But of course, yeah, if you're working on a game, you just want to take it out and put it on your bench. You know, it sits on its own rails on the floor. Has anybody got any questions at this point, or should we move to the next one? Okay, right, if you'd like to follow me down, please, what we're going to do is we're going to walk through the factory to a room at the back there. So please follow me, and I'll take you to the next part. Thank you. mentioned to you over where we were is that we already have two different lines set up there, so we could actually be running two games at any one time there. We have two lines for cabinets there, we have two lines for playfields. So you know, we already have that flexibility, but ultimately we can have as many lines as we want. So I'd like to introduce you to our latest piece of equipment. And this is a very specialised bit of equipment. This is a CMYK UV printer. It's made by originally OC, which is now Canon, and it fits 8x4 media on top of it, wood or plastic. Basically, we print all of our wood and plastics here now. And this saves us a lot of money. It allows us to keep a really close check on quality control, and we can turn things around very quickly. So. What John's going to do in a minute is we're going to print up one of the panels for you just to show you how we do it. But does anybody, can we estimate what a new machine like this would cost on the market?
90,000.
Who was that? 50,000. More than that. Less than that. It's 90,000. So this is a £90,000 piece of equipment. But the thing is, you know, if you do everything in-house, you make huge savings. And you know, quality control is one of the biggest issues a company like ours has to face, because, you know, people demand the best quality, especially if something like a pinball machine is going into a collector's zone. And so you have to be able to keep a check on that. I mean, we wanted to make a new decal panel like that. We might have to speak to the printer, maybe they've got other work on. You know, maybe you've got to order new stuff in. It could be weeks before you get another panel, whereas we can just make this, you know, like John is doing now. We just print this off as we want it. So it's a huge benefit for us.
Here's the morning. It just takes a time in loading it up, but once it goes past, it's easy. It's not going to bring it in.
What this actually allows us to do, this machine as well, is all the banners that you've seen around the place, we're printing all of our own banners too now as well.
Is the paint seen by you guys?
Yes, it is, yeah.
Okay.
There were two heat lamps on top, so by the time it's printed and it's on there, it's already dry. The thing is about this is, you can save a lot of money, you know, with like heat costs and so on. If you have to start replacing expensive parts on it, I mean, like the print heads on these are £2,500 each, and there's 10 heads on it. So if you have to replace a set, that's a cool £25,000. Absolutely, you've got. There's nothing stopping you doing it.
Happy birthday.
Yeah, why not?
That's an example of one.
Here's one we did earlier on today in the first batch. And we've actually done this a slightly different way to really make the colours even more vivid. Because the standard process would be to do CMYK ink first and then white to seal it to the back so the art is a little light and shine through it without being sort of hot spots everywhere. But we've actually done another CMYK print after the white, which just gives a real, really good depth of colours when you're looking in it through the lights. Thank you. Well, that sort of, you know, concludes our factory tour. This is already about a third of the way through its print process there. I'd say in about 5 minutes' time, then I think we're to go. So I'd just like to invite anybody if they have any questions for us at all.
How hard
would
it be to
learn all the things? This was to get our playfields printed the right way, prepared the right way. It was a 2.5 year process. I mean, we had to find this printer to do the right job. And one funny story, well, interesting story I tell people is that, I mean, I was going to printers up and down the country and had this one company and they promised the world. They said, look, we've brought all the latest printers here, you've got to come, we can do exactly the right job. And I got to this place, somewhere in the Midlands, and they had this printer and it was the size of a two-story house inside their warehouse. I mean, as you're looking up at it like this, and the print head was the size of a car. It was that big there. They were so proud of their piece of equipment there. This massive bed, and it drops down and it goes in there. And it's really impressive to see this car fly backwards and forwards inside the car. And then it came out and it was just like really poor quality. You know, this stuff is printing stuff off so you can see it being Q-sided from here. If you're standing looking at a playfield, you've got the halfway from you. know, you can't see all the dots in there. It's glowing light. So, you know, they were impressed with it, and we weren't. So we had to keep searching. In actual fact, we got the end result from a friend of ours called John Greatwich in Canada, who's actually doing some tailor-made games over there as well, we're working with. And he pointed us in this direction, and we haven't looked back since.
What's your scrap look like? How many of them?
That's a good question. You know, sometimes you get damages when they come in, sometimes through the manufacturing process, you know, you're putting a screw through and it just happens to pop through the baking surface. Yeah, that's one of my big bugbears at the moment. So that's another reason why we keep everything in-house, to make sure that we can keep a check on quality. Because, you know, quality control is such a big part of what we do. You know, when we first started doing the quality, we just thought, oh, okay, we'll have a guy at the end of the line and he'll check the quality to come top of the line. You know, we were naive back then, but then we learned the hard way, that we had to send stuff all the way back to the line to get disassembled and reassembled again. So you have to have key parts along the way, and as long as you do that, then you have a quality product by the end of the line. Yes, exactly. You can see actually, if you see the front of the machine down below, you see the ink sachets at the bottom.
Is that white stripe where it's working from?
Just be careful then, guys. Just take it and the force it back. Pops on the t-shirt, that's it, he gets back down. That's kind of the way forward. I mean, the thing is, a lot of people want to have unlicensed games and original items, but when you're in a marketplace where everybody's competing and then your competitors are doing licensed games, it's hard to have the mentality you're going to keep doing unlicensed games. So, you know, Alien Pinball is our second game, which there's a lot of excitement about. But we have two very strong licenses backed up behind, and they're all ready to be built up as prototypes now. We kind of have this bit of a backlog of games now. As I said, you know, we're looking to have, as well as Full Throttle, Alien, and two other games all released by the end of 2016. Yeah. But I mean, the thing is, we do have this backlog, so they're ready to make this prototype already now.
How many people
do you have? How many people employed? We have 15 people full time at the factory now. We've got more people coming almost on sort of a monthly basis. We work with 8 people outside of the States as well, a couple of people in France, about 6 people in America. So we try to have a mixture of some of the best up-and-coming talent and also some of the industry veterans. I mean, you know, we work with people like, from my point of view, Dennis Dortmund, John Trudeau, from an artwork point of view, Doug Watson, Jack Hager. So we're working with some really great names in the business, but bringing in people who are going to decide to do more for tomorrow.
Any chance you can reprint my Simpsons pinball party?
Sure, bring it in. Don't give the masters that. If we can do it legally, then we can do it. Right? It's all done with Santa licensing. But, you know, if you think about one thing that I really like, the direction I'd like to go to in the future, is custom pinballs too. Maybe having some generic type designs of people who want to build a game. And you know, say, this is how we're going to build it. Build it for them. But the artwork is so easy to do. You know, you have your own original artwork in the game in minutes. As you see, John started this 5 minutes ago and it's done.
That's really sharp.
Have you got a
really sharp?
Yeah, we're very happy with the quality of it.
Have you got like a local department that's just like, no, I don't know, look at that. You know, like an advisor.
I have a guy who I email regularly.
Yeah, you need to have someone like that on your side.
Yeah, you do.
You can also do something and see more later on the road.
Exactly, yeah. We have a lot of that.
Well, I just 300 DPI.
You went to 300 DPI,
yeah.
it's the best.
Yeah, I think it goes at least 600.
Oh yeah, it can go.
Yeah,
is it going to be an expert? And then you've got over 300.
Yeah,
Oh, right.